Great. Good morning, everyone. Again, this is Anna Johnson with John Burton Advocates for Youth, and we are here this morning in partnership with the Los Angeles Reproductive Health Equity Project, and we are so glad you joined us today for this webinar. We are currently inviting short-term residential treatment programs and transitioning group homes to participate in a reproductive and sexual health learning community that will involve learning from peers, youth, and reproductive and sexual health professionals to ensure positive, healthy sexual development for youth in care. And just some logistics before we get started. Today's slides can be downloaded in the handout sections of your control panel. So we've got a visual here for, you can click on those. So feel free to go ahead and download those materials now. One of the handouts is the slides. There's another handout that we'll talk about later, which is a letter of participation. And then there's another handout, which is a flyer. I know not everyone on the call today is staff or administrator of a short-term residential treatment program, but may be in conversations or discussions with organizations in your area, and this flyer could be useful for that. We are also going to ask you at multiple times to submit questions or comments, and you can do so in the questions panel. So you type your question and click send. And finally, all of our materials from today will be posted on our website. We have presenters today who are going to speak from a few different perspectives. First, Alexis Berries is going to speak about as a subject matter expert with lived experience, and she has helped to pass Senate Bill 89 into law. We also have with us Felicia Reyes from the Los Angeles Reproductive Health Equity Project in LA, and then myself. And today's agenda and what we'll cover in this webinar is sort of what was the need for Senate Bill 89 and its passage into law. What were we seeing specifically with young people in who were placed in group homes at the time, now short-term residential treatment programs? Well, you'll learn a little bit more about the LA REP project itself. And we'll also talk about what is a learning community, what are the goals of this learning community, talk about the timeline and how to sign up and participate. So just to sort of get us all on the same footing, what do we mean by a learning community? So John Burton Advocates for Youth has a strong track record of organizing effective learning communities. And what does that mean? It sort of means providing a space and structure for organizations to align around a shared goal. In this case, that goal would be having positive, healthy sexual development for youth in short-term residential treatment programs and transitioning group homes in the state of California. This learning community will help connect people across different geographies of the state, learn from each other's policies, best practices, and how different organizations have overcome barriers or issues, different trainings they've used. We'll measure collective progress together over the course of the learning community to see how are we doing in serving young people around their sexual and reproductive health needs. And finally, we'll identify opportunities to improve the field through strengthened policies and practice, including what John Burton Advocates for Youth does as policy opportunities statewide and how to further advance those reforms and improvements for reproductive and sexual health for young people. Specific goals that have been identified through initial conversations with counties and short-term residential treatment programs and young people themselves include the goals around promoting sexual health education in order to prevent unintended pregnancy, information about and access to rights and services related to pregnancy, parenting, sexual orientation, and gender identity, tools that are youth-friendly that can be used for these discussions that are age-appropriate as well. You know, if you're serving younger youth or older youth, these conversations look different depending on how that young person's body is growing and changing and developing, what is happening physically, mentally, emotionally, And there's tools out there that are free that we can connect folks with. We want to really enhance policy compliance in short-term residential treatment programs and transitioning group homes with this new law that is being newly implemented. And we want to provide training and support from the various experts. California is really resource rich in various areas. So the California Youth Connection has done sexual orientation, gender identity, and expression trainings. We have trainings that would be specific for trans youth. We have trainings from the Ombuds Office specific to the rights of youth. And we want to connect these STRTPs with those expert trainers. We also want to integrate evidence-based practice into the lived experience of the home. And finally, use this learning community to advance systemic progress with other facilities and programs statewide, and really be a model and sort of show each other the way on this topic. Just so you all know, on the phone and on the webinar, we are seeking participation, a minimum participation of at least 15 organizations to be involved. We do want geographic diversity with a minimum of 5 STRTPs from the LA area, 5 from the Bay Area, and at least 5 from other geographic locations. So we're going to be seeking some of your assistance in recruiting and having these initial discussions on participation with STRTPs across the state. And we're really looking to have that geographic diversity in order to understand what are the strengths statewide, how can we learn from each other, and what can we learn about you know, in some resource-rich areas versus none, and how do we spread that information. So that is part of our goal. And so I want to pose the first question to you all. And so if you can get ready to type into your control panel. Our question for you all is, what brings you to this work? What inspired you to join us this morning for this topic? So if you can please submit your comments in the questions panel or in the chat panel, we'll be able to read some of those out a little bit later on. So please just take a minute. Enter any comment or question that brought you to this presentation this morning. And this is how we will begin to build our community of practice starting now. Great, and so we have one person who entered a question or a comment saying that they wanted to learn more about the laws regarding this topic. That's great. We are going to have Felicia talk and Alexis talk about that as well. There are some folks who want to learn more about how STRTPs have been investigated on this topic and maybe reduce some of those compliance or concerns issues and how to kind of navigate that. Some folks have said they would like to become better prepared to address the needs of individuals in their program, which is wonderful. That's exactly what we're going to be focused on. Many of the youth that one person mentioned are in the high school population, and some of the materials, even this in this presentation, are aimed specifically to that age group. So wonderful. We have a nurse that says, you know, I've always loved to help people, and this is part of my role as a nurse, to learn about how I can support maybe folks in the STRTP community themselves. Yeah, and then we have some folks from juvenile justice side and from the commission that just want to learn more about the laws and responsibilities and to learn from others' work and the resources that are in this area. So wonderful. I'm going to keep looking at these, and I am going to build in your questions and comments into our upfront framework for this learning community. So please keep those questions coming, and thank you so much for participating. So getting into what I'm on the right slide. I'm talking to myself, everybody. So getting into the law here around what many of you said, I just want to know more about this law and how to implement it. Well, this project is following the passage of what is known as the California Foster Youth Sexual Health Education Act, Senate Bill 89, that was set into law in 2017. So we're 2 years into implementation. So that is what most people would call early implementation, where folks are moving from moving these policies into their local organization rules and guidelines, learning and training and building up their practices. This is a really critical time to have a learning community. And you're going to learn more about this bill from Alexis and Felicia, but here's sort of the overall requirements. One is to improve access to sexual health education for young people with a requirement that they receive comprehensive sexual health education in middle school and in high school. And if they miss that at their school for any reason, that the caseworker or probation officer help them get that through another opportunity, whether that's at the independent living program, through a different local organization, or set up through the STRTP to provide that, because it can be very common that young people have missed this if they've moved schools. Another key part of the law is that it is required that caregivers, in this case staff, inform youth of their rights around sexual and reproductive health and help remove any barriers to care, which could be anything on the physical health side of reproductive health or sexual health, mental health aspect, the relationship aspect, or the sexual health aspect. And so there's some really strong materials in here that we can provide and that we'll be talking through during the learning community part. Finally, that the state provides sexual health training to the adults working with youth, and that those trainings be made available so that the adult serving youth have a baseline knowledge and of what their responsibilities are, what materials exist, and how to connect those with young people. So you'll learn a little bit more, but this is our overview. And I'm going to now turn it over to a subject matter expert who has lived experience in the system, Alexis Berry, who helped pass this law and get it into law in 2017. So Alexis is an advocate at John Burton Advocates for Youth, and in this role, she advocates for policies to improve the lives of foster youth, homeless youth, and youth involved in the juvenile probation system. Alexis was formerly in foster care and was part of the first cohort of youth to participate in extended foster care to age 21. And she's a full-time student and a service provider with Uplift Family Services, providing behavioral and mental health services. In September 2018, Alexis was appointed by Governor Jerry Brown to the Homeless Coordinating and Financing Council. And so, hi, Alexis. Thank you so much for being with us today and for your work in passing this bill. Can you just tell us a little bit about yourself, what motivated you to work on passing SB 89 into law, and what advice you have for the STRTP learning community?
Absolutely. Good morning, everybody. Again, my name is Alexis Berries, and I am a former foster youth and current advocate with JBAY. So after spending a total of 18 years in the foster care system with the focus on stabilizing my placement, a notable gap was around my health, specifically my sexual reproductive health. The reality of this is not unique to me. A lot of youth lack the same treatment. This was and is a big deal because it caused an alarming amount of unintended pregnancies. According to the National Campaign to Prevent Teen and Unplanned Pregnancies, more than half of young women in foster care in California will have been pregnant at least once by 19, a rate that is 3 times greater than for non-foster youth. Not surprisingly, this leads to early childhood bearings. A University of Southern California study found that 35% of young women who were in foster care at the age of 18 gave birth by the age 21. Again, that is a rate that is more than double the rate of non-foster youth. It's worse in Sacramento County, where 37% of young women in foster care will have given birth by the age of 21. So for me and others who experience foster care, education came second to finding a bed to rest our head at night. During my time in care, I moved placements over 8 times and changed schools at least 6. What that meant for me was that I was either behind or ahead academically, mostly behind. This caused me to miss out on a lot, including my sexual education that most teens get in school. California law requires students to receive sex education once in middle school and once in high school. For most, that didn't happen because of changes of school and placement. When I missed school from all the placement changes, I was never able to make up that curriculum. In addition to that, I had no idea where to access information besides the internet. And we all know that what you read on the internet is true. No, not really. But a lot of what I learned was inaccurate. And not one of the 7 social workers that I had during my time in foster care attempted to talk about sexual health with me. The biggest issue with being placed in different households is that each foster home or program has its own cultural beliefs. In several placements, my foster parents prohibited any conversation around sex and didn't even allow us to access birth control. Group homes, STRTPs, would also confiscate birth control, disallowing teens to practice safe intercourse. This was a clear violation of our rights, but what are you supposed to do as a teenager that doesn't know any differently? I did not have an unintended pregnancy, but my older sister did. I have seen firsthand the challenges that she faced. She was unemployed, moved from shelter to shelter with her young child. And sadly, studies show that most foster kids who have children will not participate in higher education, and their children are more likely to enter foster care due to system maltreatment. As an advocate, I worked alongside JBAY to bring these concerns to the legislature to consider a proposal to invest $2.8 million in a program to prevent unintended pregnancies by providing foster kids with comprehensive sexual education, helping enforce our reproductive rights, and training child welfare professionals. The budget proposal would require that social workers track foster kids' education to make sure that they receive comprehensive sexual health education. Second, the budget proposal would ensure that youth are informed of their rights to sexual reproductive health care, no matter where they are. And finally, the proposal included training all of the child welfare personnel, including caregivers and social workers. So the questions are, how do the STRPT staff and administrators play a role in this? And what can they do to support young people? And because of the nature of this conversation, I recognize that it can be hard to engage with young people. If this is the case for you, I believe that linking them to a qualified specialist to receive this accurate information is important. Conversation is detrimental to the success of this implementation. Young people need supportive adults in their life that they can trust and consult in. And you can be just that.
Great. Thank you so much, Alexis, for sharing your thoughts and wisdom and for helping
to get this passed. So again, we're going to ask you all to think and reflect on what Alexis has just shared about her experience passing that law, why it was so necessary, and some of her upfront advice for caregivers, including STRTP staff. So please type in your questions, and we will send those questions to Alexis to then answer after our next speaker goes. So, and you can also learn more about Alexis's advocacy if you download this presentation and click on the link in the slides. So thank you so much, Alexis, and we'll hear more from you. And I'm seeing some questions come in, and we'll send you those to review.
Great.
Absolutely. Thank you.
So our next presenter is Felicitas Reyes, from the Los Angeles Reproductive Health Equity Project. And Felicia is a program associate who has graduated from the University of Southern Carolina with a degree in American Studies and Ethnicity, where she worked on several youth-centered projects. Wanting to continue her work on youth issues, she joined Just in Time for Foster Youth. And in her role, she oversaw 3 programs for transition-age youth, focusing on college and career planning, housing, mentorship, and health. And she spent this past year in Mexico on a Fulbright grant teaching English and working with migrant women and children. Her interests and work lie at the intersections of the juvenile, immigrant, education, and foster care system. Her goal is to continue to be an advocate for system-impacted youth through policy, advocacy, and community engagement. So I'll hand it over now. Thank you so much, Felicia.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Anna. Like Anna said, my name is Felicia Reyes. I'm the program associate for LA-RET. I am also a former foster youth, so this work is near and dear to my heart. And today I'm just going to talk a little bit about what is LA-RET, some reproductive and sexual health outcomes for youth in foster care, and a little bit about SB 89. So LA-RET, the Los Angeles Reproductive Health Equity Project for Foster Youth, is a private public collective impact campaign made up of different orgs here in LA County, whose goal it is to reduce inequitable sexual and reproductive health outcomes that disproportionately impact youth in foster care here in LA County. Foster youth face inequitable reproductive health outcomes, which I will speak to a little bit later. And research shows these outcomes come from system level barriers that impede young people from accessing reproductive health care and having autonomy over their bodies. The consequences from these outcomes mean a greater risk of family disruption, poorer health, and poorer educational and economic outcomes. So through this private public collective, we aim to uplift the reproductive wellness of young people in foster care. Next slide, please. I want to give a little bit of context of why LA-RET is doing this work. It's really important to look at the key disparities of young people in the foster care system in terms of young people's reproductive and sexual health. California already has a network of sexual and reproductive health information and services to address adolescent needs in general. For example, the California Healthy Youth Act, which took effect in January 2016, mandates that public middle and high schools must offer comprehensive sexual and reproductive health education for young people. There's consent rights that allow adolescents who need it to confidentially access care. There's a network of clinics specifically trained to address adolescent needs. There's public funding streams, and there's also trustworthy information for teens and adult caregivers. So this is already in place here in California. Next slide, please. Since these things have been put into place, these services and programs have effectively reduced pregnancy for teens overall. As you can see, teen birth rate in California is down 77% since 1991. That's the greatest percent reduction in the United States, along with Connecticut and Massachusetts. So California is really leading this charge. Next slide, please. Yet almost 50% of youth in foster care in California will have been pregnant by the age of 19. And that pregnancy rate is more than 2.5 times higher than the rate of young people who are not in care. So again, that California downward trend is not reflected when we are looking at young people in the foster care system. Next slide, please. For California youth in care, most of these pregnancies were not intended. This is about systemic barriers to education and care. When people hear that youth in care report pregnancy at more than 2.5 times the rate of people who are not in care, they assume these young people are getting pregnant to fill an emotional void. For example, they think that young people are trying to create a family that they themselves didn't have. This thinking essentially places the fault on young people themselves and removes accountability from the system. And although the filling an emotional void narrative may be true for some people, both in and out of the foster care system, recent studies show that the majority of the time this isn't the case. The recent study pictured here in this table asked young women and men in the system who had gotten pregnant or who had gotten a partner pregnant whether that pregnancy was wanted, and about 2/3 for both women and men said that it wasn't. And that means there's a disparity between intentionality of becoming pregnant and what is actually happening, or the reality. So we need to ask ourselves, what is getting in the way of young people accessing care that they need for the reproductive health outcomes they want for themselves? Like, where is this disparity coming from? Next slide, please. So for prenatal outcomes, you can see that for foster youth surveyed at 17 who reported pregnancy in California, that over 40% had a stillbirth or miscarriage, and over 20% never received any type of prenatal care. And just to put it in context, for the general population, granted, the population ages are not identical to this specific study, but it does give us an idea of a comparison. that in 2010, the majority of pregnancies to adolescent females ages 15 to 19 in the United States, an estimated 60% ended in a live birth compared to 35% that you see in this pie chart. And 15% ended in a miscarriage compared to over 40% that you see in this pie chart. You can see that these prenatal outcomes follow disproportionate high rates of inequitable outcomes. Next slide, please. For sexually transmitted infections, young people in the foster care system are more likely to report an STI diagnosis by age 26 than for people who are not in the foster care system. And you can see from this chart, for young women, it's almost twice the rate. Next slide, please. I think it's also important that when we talk about people in the foster care system, we have to talk about the overlapping identities that intersect and create some of the outcomes that I am going to be talking about. So you can see that racial disparities are very prevalent in the system, because in LA, over 90% of young people in care are youth of color. Next slide, please. It is also important to talk about sexual orientation and gender identity, because these various identities intersect with each other. So you can see in this slide, nationwide, over 20% of children in foster care identify as LGBTQ+. And in LA specifically, one study found that there is about twice as many people who identify as LGBTQ+ in the foster care system than those who are not in the system. And then this last bullet, you see those who identify as LGBTQ+, 83% were Black or Latinx. Next slide, please. I also wanted to talk about how youth in foster care experience unique risk and circumstances. So I'm not gonna go into a ton of detail from this chart, but I did wanna highlight a few things as they navigate the different stages of adolescence. And it's important to think about these as we consider how young people access reproductive and sexual health care. So for example, in early adolescence, trauma can trigger the onset of puberty up to 1 year earlier, and all young people experience a particular level of trauma in the system. For middle adolescence, you see that 49% report forced sex before 19. That impacts the way they're going to interact with their sexual health providers and also their sexual health in general. And then, as you can see in late adolescence, the majority of those who have been sexually trafficked have had some involvement in the foster care system. Next slide, please. When we see these differences in health outcomes of different groups, it can be helpful to think about what external factors exist that influence access to reproductive and sexual health care and the risk associated with that access. In public health, this framing is called social determinants of health, and LA REP is focused on these social determinants of health in order to change some of the outcomes that we've seen in the system. So for example, frequent changes in school and housing placement makes it difficult to access reproductive and sexual health education in schools, because the young person might have had so many transitions that they missed when schools were giving this mandatory reproductive and sexual health education. Another issue is that placements can actually have rules that make it difficult to get to a clinic or access to birth control, or even ask for information on things like abortions. And Alexis actually mentioned this when she was talking about her personal experience. And caregivers have actually reported saying they don't know what they're allowed to do when it comes to reproductive and sexual health care. So a lot of things are not very clear for the people who are responsible for the health and well-being of these youth. This just shows that there's all these different types of unique barriers to care that young people in the foster care system face. Next slide, please. LA REP has attempted to tackle some of these structural barriers around reproductive and sexual health care for young people. I'm just gonna reiterate on what Anna and Alexis said around SB 89. In 2017, LA REP sponsored a bill, SB 89, also known as the California Foster Youth Sexual Health Education Act. And this bill basically required training for social workers and caregivers on healthy sexual development. It also ensures that youth in care get comprehensive sexual health education that's available to all other youth in California. That means that if a young person doesn't get it at their schools, they have to get this education somewhere else. And then it also ensures that young people in care have the right to sexual health access with a provider of their choice, and the caregivers and social workers are mandated to make that happen. Before, there was no state guidance around these issues, but now California has put policy into place to at least get young people to the door.
Okay, great. So thank you so much, Felicia, for all of that wonderful information. And we're going to ask again that folks listening in, type into the question panel your questions on the information that was just provided by LA Rep. And then Felicia can answer some of those questions as well. So go ahead and type in those questions now. And you can learn more about LA Rep's work by downloading the slides from today's presentation and clicking on that link that we have in this slide here. And I'll just ask now, Alexis, are you able to, do you want to pick a few questions to answer that were sent to you?
Hi, everybody.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Alexis.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Yeah, so really great questions, everybody. I think that a lot of the questions kind of surface around the same topic, like how can you best support youth, specific youth, whether it be boys, LGBTQ, you know, what's the best way to address the topics with youth and approach? And I think, honestly, every situation and individual is unique. You have to develop a relationship with each of your youth, and at that point in time, that's when you determine, you know, when's the best time for us to talk about this. Is it, maybe it's not, you know, as soon as they get out of school on the drive home, but maybe we can have a conversation over dinner, we can have a conversation individually. It's all about, you know, that connection and having a connection with that young person that you're serving. So that way you are identified as a natural support and somebody, a trusted adult. It's hard to talk with strangers about, you know, personal things such as sexual reproductive health. And that's why I suggest that you get them connected to a professional who specializes in that if it's hard for you to do so. There's, you know, tons of programs in places that offer the sexual reproductive health to teenagers, young people. There's a lot of LGBTQ community centers that that have these trainings. They even have people that'll come out to you. If you have an STRTP group home and you want to host like a training night or some type of thing where you invite a professional into the home to do some kind of like interactive training with the youth, depending on like how you want to present it. I think there's tons of ideas, and I'm open to actually putting like maybe a list together and then uploading it as a document onto our site to answer these questions in better detail so that you have something to refer to. But that's just kind of like off the top of my head right now what I can think of.
Great. Thank you so much, Alexis, for thinking about some of those. And, you know, if you want to, we can come back sort of at the end of the next part of the presentation if you have any more or additional thoughts on some of those questions. There were a couple questions for Felicia. One question being, how can one address or approach the filling the empty void idea? And I don't know, Felicia, if you can think about that or come back on and answer that question.
Sorry, technical difficulties. Can you repeat the question, please?
Of course. So it says, how can one address or approach the filling the empty void idea?
Would you like me to answer that now, or do you want me to think about it first?
You can think about it first. And okay. There's another question that was asked, which is, does SB 89 programs apply to probation youth, and how many have experienced these same concerns? And then one more question for you is, do you have specific information for CSEC youth? So I don't know if you want to take a moment now to answer the probation and CSEC questions, or if you'd like to answer them after the next portion.
I'll answer them after the next portion.
Okay, great. And one more question for you. If a foster parent's moral values do not support abortion but help the youth find, we'll send you the question because it's cut off on my screen here, so I'll send you the full question. Okay. But we'll also answer that question after the next portion. So thank you everyone for continuing to send in your questions. We are going to answer those and get back to the group, and we'll continue the presentation. Great. So my portion of the presentation is really focusing on, you know, why are we putting together a learning community specifically for STRTPs and transitioning group homes, and how to sort of clarify what is the role of STRTP staff who are considered, you know, under the law, you are the caregiver, you are the prudent parent, you are the home and provider of support for young people that you are working with. So really some of what the law of SB 89 calls out, and what more detailed training on this will show, is that we're really looking for staff to connect youth with information about their rights and services. And there are state disseminated materials that part of this learning community we will take time to dive into, become familiarized with, and discuss how to really use those. That information is done in an age-appropriate way. So some folks have let us know they work with high school students. Some folks work with middle school students. And we did get one question that said, at what age do you really start having this conversation? And so to answer that question, sexual reproductive health is just part of every person's development. And as a child is growing, you want to have those age-appropriate conversations. And so at whatever age of a young person that you're working with in care, you want to start that conversation using those materials or information that's appropriate for that age. And so we'll connect you with that and how to do that. Under this law, it's points out specifically age 10 and older. So age 10 is when we start having social workers and probation officers track, have the young person received comprehensive sexual health education during their time in middle school, and what resource, and to inform them about their sexual and reproductive health rights. Another big part of the role for caregivers is to help accessing timely services. This means knowing where that service can be accessed. The young person has the right to choose their provider, their doctor. And so bringing them there, figuring out transportation to services, collaborating with the caseworker or probation officer and the public health nurse, as well as the child and family team members, to make sure that those services are accessed and are timely. And if there are any barriers that come up, that you do support the young person in receiving those. And then finally, to keep any information and conversations confidential. There's a lot more that we'll talk about as part of the learning community to really break down what does this look like? What does this sound like? What does this feel like? And, you know, there are some folks who work with only boys, there's some folks who work with through the LGBTQ perspective. There's folks who work through just serving girls or trans people who have been trafficked or commercially sexually exploited. And so there's these different needs that we will talk about and break down. And in the learning community, we'll get into specific resources and materials on all of those kinds of topics. So again, there's some research that just sort of says, why are we focusing on STRTPs and transitioning group homes? And, you know, just what we know for California is that staff are working and serving expectant and parenting youth with a history of commercial sexual exploitation, youth who identify as LGBTQ, right? And so we need to be able to be conversant and comfortable in serving all of these populations and correctly. So that is one of the main focuses, just that who you are serving and their specific needs. We're also more likely to have missed comprehensive sexual health education in school, as Alexis and Felicia mentioned. Young people who are in STRTPs or group homes have gone through at least one placement change, right, if not more. Alexis mentioned having, I believe, 7 or 8. So you can imagine how that impacts that education in school. There's also the higher risk of sexually risky behaviors due to lack of knowledge and access. So if you've missed that health education, if you've been moved around and you haven't had a stable caseworker or caregiver who's had that conversation with you, you know, where are you getting that information from? And if you have misconceptions, who's helping you to clarify those misconceptions? And then finally, there's greater barriers accessing and using protection, contraception, for protection from STIs or from unplanned pregnancy than their peers who are not in STRTPs or group homes. So these are just, again, those structural barriers that are sort of the reason why we want to provide this learning community and help STRTP staff overcome some of these barriers and better serve young people. So what we're now asking to all of you is, does your organization or the STRTPs and group homes in your community, are they looking to promote positive, healthy, and comprehensive sexual health education and services among the youth in your care? I saw lots of comments that are saying that. And so thank you for being here and thank you for joining us today. And do you want to equip your staff members with the tools and training for these, these topics that can be challenging? How do I do this? When do I start talking about this? Who is the best person to answer these questions and how do I connect them with them? So the next question that we're posing to you all is, would you like to ensure that your policies and procedures are complying with this newer state law and reduce any organizational risks? So we saw some comments about investigations or complaints. We saw some about, you know, just we want to know more about the law so we can update our policy and procedures. And then finally, to reduce these risks that were mentioned by our other two presenters around the risk that youth and young adults in foster care and in probation experience related to unintended pregnancy, low birth rate, birth weight, higher birth rates, and sexually transmitted infections. So that's sort of what we're looking for, our organizations who are ready to dive into these topics. So again, for folks who join the learning community, we are going to have detailed information, materials, conversations around policy and practice with subject matter experts from the field on a number of topics that we've talked about here. Some that are on the slide that we haven't specifically mentioned yet include, talked about most of these, so specifically the prudent and parenting standards and what does that look like in comparison with youth rights. So you might have an opinion or a belief that you think would fall under the prudent parenting standard, but as long you have to make sure that your personal beliefs aren't actually in violation of a young person's rights. So you have to kind of know both. And so we also have more technical topics like how do we, what are our storage policies say? How do we provide transportation if we have a staff out sick? How do we make sure that a young person gets timely care if they're experiencing symptoms related to an STI or if they need timely access to birth control? So these are the questions that we'll be diving deeper into. And, you know, of course, please put into the chat or to the comments and questions section here any topics that you would like to be part of this learning community. And so please just type those in. I'm going to look at all of your comments and answer and include those into the development of our monthly technical assistance. So now I'm going to talk about, you know, this learning community timeline. You know, when are we starting? How do we get started? What does it really mean to be a part of this learning community? So right now we are in the phase of outreach and participation. So between now and December, I am asking all of you to circulate this flyer within your networks. It's in the handout section of your control panel. Circulate the webinar materials that will be posted on our website after this presentation to those STRTPs and transitioning group homes in your networks who you think are interested in this. Between November and December 15th, we're looking for letters to be submitted of participation. We've provided a template letter that basically just says, you know, this is our STRTP here. We have our approval to join this learning community. We'd like to be a part of it. Here's why. And just sort of send that back to me so that I know how many folks are interested and so that we can start to develop a catered learning community to your needs. And then by the end of 2019, we're going to reach back out and confirm participation with those groups who have let us know that they are interested in participating. And so in order to participate, just sort of, for these discussions that folks may be having is, you know, getting the authorization of your director to make sure that this is something that you'll be able to participate in, identifying a staff member who can serve as a point of contact for the project, and the willingness of the project point of contact to spend 2 hours a month starting in March of 2020 through June of 2021 in those technical assistance and training conversations. And I'll go a little bit more into that next. So once we get a letter and confirm participation from the STRTPs and group homes, we are going to have a self-assessment between January and March where that STRTP point of contact will work with their organization to self-assess what are their strengths in their policies, where do they have maybe policy gaps on certain topics that we can help fill in over the course of the current learning community, and what are the experiences of staff and young people, and how can we strengthen and improve those. Part of that self-assessment will be to gather youth input from the home, and also to review the historic and ongoing strengths, needs, and issues. As part of a learning community, we want people to share their strengths, share their training, share their strong policy with each other so that we can learn from each other in the field. We'll then have a kickoff in March of 2020 in Los Angeles. Transportation and food will be provided to the participants in that kickoff meeting. We're going to do community building, a day-long training that's going to go through the different parts of the law specifically for what that means for STRTP caregivers and review in depth more of those topics. Many of those topics will reflect what was noted in those STRTP self-assessments as strengths and needs. And then we'll review the existing materials and discuss materials that John Burton Advocates for Youth will be creating that might not exist yet or that we'll need to get from subject matter experts and professionals in the field. And then we'll be prioritizing and sort of setting the tone for the upcoming month's training and technical assistance topics so that we're supporting the needs of that learning community in a structured way. So from that co-designed priorities of topics, we'll be organizing through video calls or small group calls, depending on folks' needs, monthly 2 hours of participation, where we'll be sharing best practices, the how-tos, sharing policy, sharing materials, or providing a specific trainer. So we have talked to folks at California Youth Connection about their SOGI training. We have talked with folks from the Ombuds Office about the potential of having a rights training. We have talked with the LA LGBT Center
about a training specific to trans youth. We are talking with experts about a training that's specific to boys' needs. And so we have gotten this kind of feedback and have started to do that. But again, those trainings that will be provided on a monthly basis, we are going to tailor based on the group's decisions and what their needs are right now. Finally, towards the end of the project, we are hoping to do a post-assessment that will be the same as the pre-assessment to review policy, practice, and experience, and to see again any progress that we've noted with strengths, needs, and issues, and again, notice if there's any need for future guest speakers or trainers to get people connected with as the learning community is coming to a close. And finally, what I'll say with the point of doing this post-assessment and gathering feedback and input is we're really looking for what are things that work, that are scalable, that can help implementation of this SB 89 law statewide. And so this learning community will really be working with each other to serve as a model and the how-tos for others in our greater California community. And then finally, we're going to celebrate and educate. We're going to share those practices, policy, and materials developed and circulate with all of our networks. It'll be posted on our website. And we'll assess the opportunity for policy change, as I noted. And we'll also know how to keep in touch and do this work ongoing. And finally, we're going to celebrate all of these improvements and set ongoing goals. So that is the timeline. Before I take questions, and please type in your questions about that timeline or participation, but we are providing links here to the available materials that we do have currently, including the all county letters and all county information notices that have been put out by the state to clarify the law and what that looks like and means. So again, feel free to use these links. I did see one comment that said maybe the links weren't working that well if from the downloaded presentation. If that's the case, we're going to fix those links and have this all up on our website, making sure that everything works for everybody. So just let us know if that's the case. But we do have these resources available. Next, for the participation process, again, our next steps are to discuss this interest, identify staff from the administration, training, and direct care perspective of the STRTP and transitioning group home. It's going to mean a little bit of youth participation during those self-assessments. And finally, you know, to just have that conversation, is this something that we're interested in? And finally, submitting that letter of participation that is downloadable in the control panel to myself, hopefully by December 15th, so we can get an idea of who we're working with, start scheduling that kickoff meeting, and start organizing the materials so that we are aligning this learning community with the needs of the participants. So now, if you can send any questions that you have for me about the learning community timeline, participation, what that looks like. We also have a website where you can see where you can see more of the information, the flyer, and everything's all on there as well. So, where am I going? Talking to myself here. I'm going to look at the questions. There we go. Okay. So one of the questions says that there is concern that the law passed in 2017 and compliance is required now, and we can't wait until 6/21 to start compliance. And so I hear that loud and clear. So number one, that is why in our presentation, we are providing the links to the all county letters, to all of the resources and materials that are already available so that folks can start moving. We're also going to design that pre-assessment so that folks can look now at where might be the gaps in policy so that that could be addressed sooner. And we're going to move the timeline of those trainings to help STRTPs come into compliance as soon as possible
in these various areas. So we are going to be co-designing that with the needs of the group. So that's what I can say about the timeline. And to build a community of practice, you know, it is definitely one thing to put policy and training into place, and it is another to have that be realized in action and to have that be felt by young people in the placement. And that's really where this community of practice comes in, where we support each other in having the home sort of reflect those changes that are newer, and how does our practice change as we learn more and are connected more. So thank you for that question and for the urgency around this very important topic. There's another comment that says, I'm assuming you'll be including the 6 principles of sexual health that we learned from the Harvey Institute in your learning community. And I'll be happy to circulate that resource, and thank you for that suggestion. There's a big push here and want for staff training, which I'll say that the day-long kickoff in March will include a lot of that material and resources and all of the available training that we know is out there for folks to take back to their STRTPs and start to use right away. And then we're going to be providing more ongoing topic-specific training from there. So thank you for that comment. Let's see, and we have a comment about a program that exclusively serves pregnant and parenting teens in foster care from a registered nurse and a public health nurse and a licensed clinical social worker who would like to be involved. So thank you so much for wanting to join us and be a part of this and to offer your expertise. And we will reach out to you to be part of this community as a subject matter expert. Thank you so much. Also, feel free to download that letter of participation and send it in to me so that we're good to go on the logistics end. Great. So let me see if any new comments, questions came in. I'm just seeing some confirmation that people may be interested in participating. So again, you know, if you have a direct contact you'd like me to have a one-on-one conversation with, or circulating that flyer, emailing directly with myself, we will get the conversation going between now and mid-December to really get folks signed up into the learning community. And then finally, there's one more question that says, are there any questions specific to CSEC youth and group homes that you can share? So yes, there are. There is a lot of specific materials and training, and that will definitely be one specialized monthly topic area, as well as part of the day-long March 2020 kickoff. So the answer to that is yes, and please feel free to reach out to me to continue that conversation. Let me go on I'll bring it back to, I'll ask Alexis one more time if there was anything else you wanted to add based on the questions that you've heard or seen from the rest of the webinar.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity. I think that I'm going to reflect back to what I said earlier about the Q&A document, that I want to have a little bit more time to prepare something in detail, and then we'll post that on our site.
Great. Thank you so much, Alexis. And then I'll also ask Felicia if you would like to chime in with any answers to some of those questions that you received for your portion of the presentation.
Hi. Yeah, I did want to talk just about, I think, two of the questions mentioned information specifically for CSEC youth as well as probation youth. And yes, SB 89 is applicable to youth in probation and youth who are CSEC involved in child welfare or probation. I think also someone mentioned a question about how to get over filling the emotional void, and I believe how they get over that narrative of young people that they have. I'm assuming that's what they were talking about. So I think it's really important to, one, recognize your bias and put that bias aside when you're talking to young people and really talk to them on a personal, deep level and be supportive of their sexual health journey. Because at the end of the day, it's their journey, their choice, and their bodies. And what we need to do is be supportive advocates for their sexual and reproductive health well-being. And that means them having the choices to choose what that is and to choose what that looks like.
Great, thank you so much. There's one other question and sort of just a theme. I was just reviewing the questions and comments that people have shared, and thank you so much for all of these. Folks are saying, you know, we are serving young people that have higher needs or specific risky behaviors, and we want to know how to best serve them. Or they've sent me specific topics around sexual health, around LGBTQ, CSEC probation specific issues. So what I will say about all of this is that we have provided some initial links on, I don't know, Carolyn, if you can go back up to the slide 37. We've provided some initial links, and on the LA Rep website as well, and on the John Burton Advocates for Youth website, there are more readily available materials starting right now that you can look into. However, what I know as a former teacher of 8 years and as an adult educator as well, that in order to really begin connecting real life situations where we're talking to a young person and something comes up, to be able to click and remember, oh, I remember that this material exists and I know, I remember where to get it and I can come back and get that to you, right? That there's some linkages in our own practice that we need to take, and part of why we're doing the monthly calls and the day-long training is to give enough time to be immersed into these resources that we ourselves become familiarized with them and can pull them up on cue as we're serving young people. And so that is really a part of not just saying, hey, don't worry about it, there's a link, but getting into the details of that, looking through the materials, any technical questions about how do I use this? Do I just hand it to them? What do I say? How do I say it? How do I, you know, what do I do if there's this conflict here? What's the best way? We're going to get into the details of all of that. But for those of you with high urgency right now today, please go ahead, get in there, click on those links, use those materials now, and we'll continue to learn together. So the other thing that I'll offer is if you would like to learn more, on the next slide, on slide 40, John Burton Advocates for Youth with my colleague here, Carolyn, is presenting a policy brief webinar specific to SB 89. And that is going to be on Thursday, December 5th at 10 a.m. The link to register is in the slides and on our website. And what that conversation is going to be about is the specific component parts of implementation in 5 Bay Area counties and how those counties are progressing in that implementation and what can be done to sort of, again, improve that implementation. So the webinar is going to inform our collective understanding of best practices and obstacles, and it's going to go into really specific details about what does it mean to train. What does it mean to link a young person to their sexual health education? And it's going to call out some of the best practices from those 5 counties on the progress that they've made and link you to that information. So feel free, if you want to learn more in depth about the law, you know, join our learning community and also join this webinar. And finally, I'll just say, let's continue this conversation. Our emails are here. You have our handouts and resources, and we are here to support you in this work and want to, you know, just say please reach out, and we are here to connect with you and to better serve young people in our communities and in our short-term residential treatment program. So thank you so very much, and I will stay on the line here. If there are any additional questions, I'll be happy to answer those now, and you can also feel free to just send me an email right now if you want to keep the conversation going. But again, my final request would be, please consider filling out that letter of participation, circulating that to other, if you are not yourself working at an STRTP, but know folks who do, please circulate that and we will get our community of practice started. Thank you so much. So I did get one more question. Are you working with Department of Education, probation, and foster youth school programs? Thank you so much for that. Yes, while the Department of Education, there are local education agencies who are responsible for providing the comprehensive sexual health curriculum to students in school. And what happens is the social worker or probation officer has to call the school directly to confirm if the young person has received comprehensive sexual health education or not. And if they haven't, then how do they have to work together to figure out a way to provide that to the young person. So there's a lot of direct connection there. One of the best practices that we're going to be talking about in the learning community has to do with creating faster sort of connections, so it's not the caseworker calling each historic school, finding the right person to talk to. What is a more effective way of getting that sort of attendance record, transcript record sent to the caseworker or the probation officer on a more frequent basis through existing memorandums of understanding or data? But absolutely yes. And there's a whole section of our SB 89 policy brief that is coming out, and that will be discussed as part of the December 5th webinar as well. Let's see if there's any more questions. All right, so it looks like we are done with questions. And I'll just say one more time, thank you to our panelists and thank you to our attendees for joining us today. And please, reach out with any more questions or needs or interests, and have a good rest of the day.